After the Delhi Sultanate, Mughal Empire came to power. In this class, we would focus on the period of 1526 to 1556, where we would study about Babur, Humayun, and the intermittent period with Sher Shah Suri, after which Humayun again came to power. So that would be the basis of understanding the foundations of Mughal Empire. Babur laid the foundations of Mughal Empire in India. He was very proud of his ancestry. From the side of his father, he belonged to the dynasty of Timur, and from the side of his mother, he belonged to the dynasty of Genghis Khan. Now, when he was born in 1483, at a very young age of only 11 years, he came to power and he was at the throne of Fargan in Uzbekistan. Later on, within 3 years, at only 14 years, he conquered Samarkand. He was known for his war tactics, and therefore his artillery and cavalry were known for power. After a few years, both the territories, however, were lost by Babur. Later on, Daulat Khan, who was the governor of Punjab and the uncle of Ibrahim Lodi, invited Babur to invade India, because India at that time was broken into small independent kingdoms, and Babur saw this as a vantage point. So in 1526, Babur invaded India. The first battle of Panipat between Babur and Ibrahim Lodi, and this was the foundation ground for the establishment of Mughal Empire in India. With his warfare tactics, better army, artillery and cavalry, he was able to defeat Ibrahim Lodi. However, there was a tough call for Babur, because Rajputs and Afghans were also in power in the nearby provinces, and the idea of Babur was consolidation of most of the regions. So Babur did not stop after the Battle of Panipat. When his soldiers got lethargic, he continuously motivated them and said that it is not sensible to stop when the goal is very close. So he motivated his soldiers and broke his glass of wine, gave up wine and said that this is how we should proceed, and his soldiers wholeheartedly supported him. So from 1526, within just 1 year, he invaded Khandwa. At Khandwa, there was a fierce battle fought between Rana Sanga of Mewar and Babur. Again, Rajputs were defeated here. Babur won undisputedly, but Rajputs still did not give up. In 1528, there was another fierce battle, and that was at Chanderi. This battle again happened with the Rajput kings, and Babur again won. Now, moving from the Delhi Sultanate, defeating the Lodis, he defeated the Rajputs at the two battles of Khandwa and Chanderi. Later on, there was another strong power, which were Afghans, closer to the region of Ghaggar River. So there was next year, in 1529, the fierce battle at Ghaggar that took place with the Afghan rulers. Babur defeated the Afghan rulers and had an undisputed territory over most of the North India. However, after his victories, he could not survive longer, and in 1530, he died, just next year after the Battle of Ghaggar. Now, his death story has a legend to tell. His eldest son, who was Nasiruddin, also known as Humayun, Humayun word meaning fortunate, was seriously ill. Babur moved around his bed 3 times, praying for his good health, and said that all his illness should go to Babur and his son should get well. Finally, that happened. His son slowly started to recover and the health of Babur started to deteriorate. Finally, despite of all the facilities and medical facilities available during that time, Babur could not be saved and had his last breath in 1530. However, his establishment of Mughal Empire was a remarkable period in the history. He was a military genius of his time. He was a very well-known author and a poet. His warfare techniques, mainly the artillery and the cavalry, and maintaining both together, was a very unique culture that was witnessed. He was an orthodox Sunni Muslim, but he was not a fanatic. He did not allow ulemas to influence the decisions that Babur wanted to take. Also, he wrote his own story, that is the autobiography, that was in the name of Tuzuk-e-Baburi. This was written in Turkish language and is also known as Baburnama. He established numerous gardens and orchards in most of the regions. Agra, Dholpur, Fatehpur Sikri are some of those two quotes. So, development of art and architecture started to flourish with the advent of Mughal Empire in India. After Babur, his son Humayun came to power. Humayun, the original name was Nasiruddin, also known as Humayun. The word Humayun means fortunate. Now, Humayun had a tough time. He had a fierce fight from three main regions. From the region of Gujarat and Malwa, Bahadur Shah was the main person whom he had a tough battle with. The next was the fight with Sher Shah Suri. He was an Afghan ruler from Bihar. And also his own three brothers, Kamran, Hindal and Askari, who were initially very, very hostile towards Humayun. Now, Humayun established his empire in India from a period of 1530 to 1540, and later on he came back to India in 1555 but could live only for 1 year before his death till 1556. We would understand these two periods and the intermittent period from 1540 to 1555 was the period where Afghan rulers came to power, and this was the period where Mughal dynasty had to withdraw because Humayun went back to his exile in Persia, and that was the period Sher Shah Suri came to power in India. Now, the first battle Humayun had to face was with his own brother Kamran. Kamran had numerous revolts with Humayun in the regions of Bundelkhand, Jaunpur, Bihar, and was able to suppress most of the areas where Humayun was trying to establish power. However, at the same time, Bahadur Shah was revolting. As we said, Bahadur Shah was in power in the regions of Gujarat and Malwa, and in this region, Humayun had a battle with Bahadur Shah. Humayun was able to defeat Bahadur Shah in 1535, but at the same time, Sher Shah Suri took advantage that Humayun is fighting in the regions of Gujarat and Malwa, so he started to establish his strength in the regions of Bihar and present West Bengal. So what happened next was, there was another battle in 1538 at Chunar. Humayun was able to win the battle in Chunar, but the next year there was battle with Sher Shah Suri at Chausa in Bihar. The battle at Chausa, Humayun was defeated. Humayun was defeated badly. Sher Shah Suri won. He resumed to power and assumed his title. He was originally Farid Khan and assumed the title Sher Shah. Now, at this point, Humayun started to become weak. His brother Kamran, who later united with him, took his army of 10,000 soldiers and went back to Lahore. This further weakened Humayun, but still Humayun did not lose heart. In 1540, at Battle of Kannauj, Humayun and Shershah Suri again had a tough fight. Humayun was badly defeated again. However, at this point, his brother Kamran left him, but his other two brothers, Aksari and Hindal, were with him fighting against Shershah Suri. Despite of that, Shershah Suri won. At this point, Shershah Suri came to power and became the ruler at the throne of Delhi. At the same time, Humayun moved to exile in the regions in Persia in Iran. Now, when he moved away, he realized that he need to consolidate power again. He wandered in the regions of Rajasthan and Sindh for many years before he moved to Persia. Once he was back in Persia, he started to gather strength and power again. At that time, Delhi was being ruled by Shershah Suri, the Afghan ruler. From Persia, he moved in 1545 to the regions of Kandahar and Kabul and started to develop and strengthen his forces. At that point, he heard that Shershah Suri had an unexpected death in 1545. The successors of Shershah Suri were inefficient and weak. So Humayun planned to invade India again. So he invaded India again in 1555, and 1555 was the year when Humayun came to power again and Mughal dynasty regained its power in India. He lived here for only 1 year before his death in 1556. He simply, in an accidental fall from the staircase of his library, fell down, and that was the point Humayun lost his life. About Humayun, his sister Gulbadan Begum wrote the biography of Humayun in the name of Humayunnama. So this was how Humayun remained in power from 1530 to 1540. He went back to Persia. He developed his forces in the regions of Kandahar and Kabul again and further invaded back to India and remained in power in India for another year from 1555 to 1556. So Humayun ruled for two different time slots in India, and between that there was the period where Shershah Suri was in power. Shershah Suri, a Afghan ruler, ruled India from 1540 to 1545, and then later on, till Humayun came back, there were the other Afghan rulers who remained in power. Shershah Suri was an Afghan ruler who remained in power from 1540 to 1545. Now, his 5 years were known for numerous developments in road and postal network, and he developed the arteries of the empire, the well-known road network, the Grand Trunk Road. He was the son of a Jagirdar of Sasaram in Bihar region, and his original name was Farid Khan. One day he was hunting a tiger, and when he killed the tiger, he was named as Shershah. He was known for his bravery. He was a ruler who appointed soldiers himself personally and paid them personally. He believed in maintaining a very strong force. He conquered numerous provinces of Punjab, Multan, Sindh, regions of Gujarat, Malwa, the Gwalior, Malwa and Rajasthan. And he defeated Humayun twice, at the Battle of Chausa and at the Battle of Kannauj. However, after he defeated Humayun, he came to power to the throne of Delhi. Now, as we know, in the Battle of Chausa, Shershah Suri and Humayun had a fight, and Shershah Suri won, established himself as the king of Bihar. Later on, however, the brother of Humayun left, the Kamran, the brother of Humayun, Kamran, left back to Lahore with 10,000 soldiers, Humayun did not lose heart. He had again a battle with remaining two brothers and he fought Sher Shah Suri again at Kannauj in 1540. However, Sher Shah Suri again defeated Humayun and finally acceded to the throne of Delhi. He ruled Delhi from 1540 to 1545 till his last breath. At that point, when after the defeat at Kannauj, Humayun left to exile in Persia, he wandered in the regions of Rajasthan and Sindh for few years and then moved to Persia, later moved back to the region of Kandahar and Kabul, where he gathered his forces and started to build his army again. When Humayun got to know the news that Sher Shah Suri is no more and his successors are weak and inefficient, Humayun started to invade India again, and Humayun invaded India again and came to power in 1555. However, the time of Sher Shah Suri as a ruler has been well known in history. As we previously mentioned, he built the famous Grand Trunk Road from Peshawar to Sonargaon in Bengal, and from Peshawar to Sonargaon, the Grand Trunk Road was a well-known development. He believed that roads are the arteries of the empire and must be strengthened. He also built in subsequent roads. For example, from Lahore, he developed an artery to Multan. From Agra, he developed an artery to Chittor. From Peshawar to Kabul and Sonargaon to Dhaka were the developments which were seen. If we focus on the works of Sher Shah Suri, he was a liberal and a secular leader. He worked for the welfare of all religions, equally placed Hindus and Muslims. As he was known for building roads, network and a strong postal system, definitely people would travel, and with the travel they would require shelter places, so he built in numerous sarais. Nearly 1700 sarais were built by Sher Shah Suri. Along the sarais and in the path there were numerous trees that were planted. When it comes to warfare, he had a huge army. As we previously mentioned, he recruited the soldiers and paid them personally. The salary was given in cash. He revived the system that was launched by Alauddin Khilji, and the system was Dagh and Chera. Dagh was the revival of horses and Chera was the role of soldiers. Similarly, he divided the land into three categories, good, average and bad, and land revenue was based on how fertile the land is. The taxes were collected either in cash or in kind. In kind means in form of some gift. The share of the government in the revenue collection was 1/4 of the total produce. Sher Shah Suri was very, very strict with revenue collections. However, he went liberal in the years when there was drought or when there was flood and believed that loans should be granted generously. Also, when it comes to land reforms, his two land reforms are well known. Those are the Patta and the Kubaliyat. Patta is the title deed of the land and Kubaliyat is the agreement. Both of these talk about the land agreement holdings and the amount of revenue that has to be paid by the peasants. So, his both of the systems for land revenue were well brought by the common people. When it comes to development of forts and architecture, his works are again well known. He built the Purana Qila. Purana Qila had a masjid, Qila-e-Khun Masjid, which is again important. His own mausoleum has been built in Sasaram, his hometown in Bihar, and he also built a fort at Rohtasgarh. When it comes to currency, he introduced the silver coins. These silver coins were known as rupiah, and the present day rupee is a derivative of this rupiah. Now this rupee is the currency which is seen in the Indian subcontinent. So India, Pakistan, Nepal, Sri Lanka, Mauritius, Seychelles, all of these have rupee as the currency. Coming on to his administration was again unique. The empire was divided into 47 sarkars. Each of these Sarkar was further divided into Pargan, and the Pargans were further divided into smaller villages. Now, with each of the Sarkar, there was the head of the Sarkar. Now, the head of the Sarkar was very, very important. The head were in two terms, law and order and revenue collection. So, it was Shikidar A. Shikadaran and Munsif A. Munsifan. Munsif and Munsif A. Munsifan were responsible for revenue collection. Shikadar A. Shikadaran were responsible for law and order. Also, Qazis were well placed. In the Parganas, Munsif and Shikadar were there. So, understand, Parganas were the lower units. Bigger than Pargana were the Sarkar, and at the Sarkar we had Shikadar A. Shikadaran. However, at the Pargana, which is the lower unit, we had only Shikadar. Similarly, at the Sarkar we had Munsif A. Munsipan, but at the Pargana level it was only Munsif. So Munsif again responsible for revenue, Shikadar responsible for law and order. And then at the village level there were Mukaddam, Kotwal and Patwari. Patwari were related to land deeds, Kotwal related to police, and Mukaddam related for special deals. Now, this was how Sher Shah Suri came to power. However, Sher Shah Suri died in 1545. As we mentioned, his successors were weak, and Humayun, who was gathering his strong force in the regions of Kabul and Kandahar, attacked India again and came to throne in 1555 after the weak and inefficient Afghan successors of Sher Shah Suri were defeated. So that was the history how Mughal Empire again came to power with Humayun. But Humayun again remained in power for just 1 year. He died in 1556.